Three steps are clear. Now we go to fourth. This is that you see the V1 anterolateral, see the V2 anterolateral portion of foramen rotundum needs to be drilled so that we can retract V2, so that we can mobilize V2, and then is the removal of anterolateral boundary of foramen ovale so that we can retract V3. Because unless we retract V2 and V3, we will not be able to reach to the petrous apex or that area, because this Gasserian ganglion has to be mobilized in order to reach to that area. And the sixth step is that removal of the bone in the Glasscox triangle, which is a posterolateral triangle bordered by arcuate eminence, foramen spinosum, and GSPM for exposure of ICA, which can be used for a proximal control or for bypass. So this step depends on purpose, that what purpose you want to use this approach. Now the intradural steps. As I told you, three limb incision, that frontal side dura opened, temporal side dura opened, and then dura along the sylvian fissure also opened, right? So this is a three limb dural incision. Now when you open the dura along the sylvian fissure, you have to incise that both the dural rings over the carotid. So a proximal carotid ring is when the carotid artery comes out of cavernous sinus. This is the proximal ring. When carotid artery becomes intradural, this is distal ring. And in between these two is the clinoidal segment or C3 part of internal carotid artery, and which is the part where the keratico-ophthalmic aneurysms arise. Third portion is that you open the dura along, you can see through the dura, you will be able to see the carotid, and just on the side of carotid you will see third nerve. So with third nerve, the dura over the third nerve is incised so that you can mobilize third nerve. The whole idea is to, because you need to mobilize these nerves in order to reach to that area or behind these structures. Now the fourth step is, again, you have incised the dura over the third nerve. Now you incise the dura over the fourth nerve. This is the fourth step. Now you have incised over the fourth nerve. Now you incise the dura over the fifth nerve. That is the V1. And V1 means when you incise this dura, it will take you to the Meckel's cave. So this is the area which can be very well explored this. And now you have incised the fifth nerve, now you incise the dura over sixth nerve, Dorolos canal. So this becomes the sixth step. So very simple to remember. And now this is one Dolenk approach video where you see I'm defining the endosteal and periosteal layers of the dura. And now see both the dura layers. Now with the dissector only, I just peel it off. This is on the temporal side. So as I told you earlier, first on the temporal side. So you just peel off both the layers of the dura. And now this is the anterior clinoid process which is being drilled. And you can just make cuts with the fine scissors. You will find this plane, and you really during surgery, whether cadaver or live, this plane is very easy to find. And now this anterior clinoid process is removed. And this is wrong. See, this big piece should not be removed. It should have been drilled more and more. But what happened when I was drilling it? It became free. So this is why first disconnected from lesser wing, then the optic roof, and then from the base. So here what happened while drilling the lesser wing, the optic strut also got drilled. So this is why this fragment became free. But don't do that. Now this is the layer. You see, what I am doing is with the dural forceps, I hold the dura and just peel it off. So two layers, you can just peel them. And now you see the tumor is already flowing, started flowing. So this is the classical Dolenz approach, where you separate these dura, and in between these nerves, wherever the tumor is coming most, you decompress the tumor. Okay, so now are the triangles. And about the triangles, I will tell you, there are 10 triangles of cavernous sinus. So you, I think you need not to bother. You all have passed MCS. This is okay for MCS going in an exam. They may ask this triangle and that triangle. So I will tell you the crux. Three triangles are most important in present day, in this exercise or in this approach. One is Dolenz triangle, I have told you already. Other is Kawase's triangle. And third is the posterolateral triangle, that is the Glasscox triangle. Three triangles are very important for the neurosurgeon. This Dolenz triangle is for keratoco-ophthalmic aneurysms, for approaching the C3 part of internal carotid. The Kawase triangle is important for anterior petrosectomy, resection of the petrous tip for tumors or aneurysms, like including the basilar top aneurysm. And third triangle is to expose the carotid artery for bypass or proximal control, like we discussed earlier in this area. So these three triangles, you need not to remember the names and all that of all triangles, right? So these three triangles are very important. So you just remember these three triangles. And if you don't want to remember these three triangles, just remember one thing, that GSPN is the place underneath which carotid artery is found. So whenever you are working in this area, don't go close to the GSPN, don't injure the carotid, and that's it. The medial to GSPN is Kawase's triangle, lateral to GSPN is Glasscox triangle, where ICA is there, medially where petrous tip is there, and this Dolenz triangle. So just remember these three things. For historical purposes, two Mullan's triangle and Parkinson's triangle, they were used to be important in those days, because at that time neuro intervention was not available, vascular intervention. So what they used to do is, for this keratoco-cavernous fistula and for approach, these triangles were important. But now we are not approaching for those lesions, these triangles, so it's not important in these days. Okay? So just remember GSPN, under which ICA is there, lateral to drill. If you drill just lateral to this GSPN, you can dissect or explore the ICA, which may be required for the purpose of proximal control of aneurysm or for bypass. If you want to remove the petrous apex, you have to remain medial to GSPN. So this is the thing which is need to be remembered. And now see, these are the old track. If you see this diagram just carefully, it's very simple, that you start from second nerve, go up to sixth nerve. In sequence, you will see all the triangles. In between the second and third nerve is Dolenz triangle, where ICA is there. Then next nerve comes is fourth nerve. So in between third and fourth nerve is one triangle. In between fourth nerve and V1 is another triangle. In between V1 and V2 is another triangle. In between V2 and V3 is another triangle. In between V3 and GSPN is one triangle. In external to GSPN is another triangle. And now comes the abducent. Medial to abducent is another triangle, and lateral to abducent is another. So these are just theoretical dural compartments which you need not to remove. And this is how these 10 triangles are formed. And before surgery, you may not be able to decide that which triangle you are going to use for removal of this some tumor or some region. So there only you have to see that the area between V1 and V2 is widened, tumor is bulging more in this area, so better go in this area. So this is why anatomy is important, to know the anatomy. And this is the anatomy right from here. If you start seeing the second nerve, and just lateral to second nerve is third nerve, lateral to third nerve is trochlear nerve, lateral to trochlear is V1, lateral to that is V2, further lateral is V3. So like these are all arranged in sequence. So like this is a just to further go into detail, you may not remember this. This is the first triangle is the Hakuba triangle, and Hakuba triangle is nothing but anterior and petrous petrocolumnar dural folds. So importance of this triangle is that if you cut these dural folds, you will be able to mobilize the third nerve. So this is one triangle. Second is clinoidal or anteromedial triangle or Dolling's triangle. This is the optic nerve, oculomotor, and tentorial edge forms the base. So the content is anteroclinoid process. If you remove the anteroclinoid process, what will come? ICL. Now is the supratrochlear triangle. Again, see, it is in between the third nerve and fourth nerve. So the name is supratrochlear. So the borders are third nerve, fourth nerve, and tentorial edge. And content is meningohypophyseal trunk. So this may be important while you are doing petroclival meningioma, and in this triangle, if you see this meningohypophyseal, it may be artery supplying to the tumor. So if you see this artery coagulated, so your vascular supply will go. So this is what is the importance of knowing this. Then comes the Parkinson's or infratrochlear triangle. The boundary is again fourth nerve and V1. And tentorial edge is the base always, because the tentorial margin is there. And contents are cavernous ICA. So this was the portion of ICA, and this is why the importance of Parkinson's triangle to treat the keratoco-cavernous fistulas in those days, maybe about 60-70 years back. So this is why these triangles have come and taken place in the books. Now is the anteromedial or Mullen's triangle, again in between V1 and V2. And here the content is again ophthalmic vein. So you could reach to those fistulas through ophthalmic vein also. So this is why these Parkinson and Mullen's triangle were important at that time. Now they don't carry that much importance. Now comes the anterolateral triangle. It is between the V2 and V3. And the content is sphenoid sinus or sphenoid bone. Now seventh is the posterolateral or Glasgow's triangle. Here it is in between the V3 GSPN, and the content is horizontal ICA, which can be used for proximal control or for anastomosis. So this is the posterolateral or Glasscox triangle. Now is the posteromedial or Cavassé's triangle. So one boundary is common, that is GSPN. If you are lateral to GSPN, it is Glasscox triangle. If you are medial to GSPN, it is Cavassé's triangle. And content is petrous FX. And Cavassé's triangle and Glasgow's triangle can be combined, and this is what is called a quadrangle. If you combine these both triangles, it is the quadrangle. Importance of this is that you preserve the carotid, but you can open the ICA, internal acoustic meatus, the dural covering of internal acoustic meatus also, if you tell that. So we'll come to that. So these are the eight, and 9 and 10 triangles are related to abducent nerve. If it is medial to sixth nerve, it is the inferomedial. If it is lateral to sixth nerve, it is the inferolateral triangle, which is not very important. So these are the 10 triangles. But one thing remember is GSPN. Under GSPN is ICA. So this is, I think, last small talk about anterior petrosectomy. So if you see a root of zygoma on a skull, that foramen ovale is medial to anterior edge of this root of zygoma. Foramen spinosum is medial to midpoint of this root of zygoma. And geniculate ganglion is medial to the posterior edge of this zygomatic root. And this is the diagram. If you see, this is the root of zygoma. There is nothing but a linear incision given in temporal region. Just we have reflected the flaps, and you see dissected the root of zygoma, which is just above the ear, above the ear, external auditor meatus. And if you see the root of zygoma, this is just to give you a surface anatomy of this, that at the midpoint, if you retract it, is the spinosum, and anterior is ovale, and posterior is genicular ganglion. So this is important to know in Kawase's approach. Now for Kawase's craniotomy, the surgical approach, that is the reflection of dura or dissection of extradural dissection, is from posterior to anterior. So a craniotomy should be either half and half, anterior and posterior to the external rotated meatus, or it should be 2/3 posterior, 1/3 anterior. If you see this in relation to the zygomatic arch, your craniotomy should be like this for Kawase's approach. And again, for Kawase's approach also, you need not to do FTOZ. It is just a simple temporal linear incision can do your job. And now there is a part, a subtemporal groove, which we will show. Just remind me there in the dissection hall. Subtemporal groove, which needs to be drilled while reflecting the dura, follow the middle meningeal artery, and that will take you to foramen spinosum. And the V3, that is the mandibular branch, which comes out through the foramen ovale, is medial and anterior to foramen spinosum. Here, this is the dissection. If you see the middle meningeal artery and V3, it is medial and anterior to it. Okay. Now, dura propria elevation, as I told you, the two layers of dura, it is started by making an incision between dura covering the temporal lobe and fibrous tissue covering the V3. So, over the V3, if you give a nick, you will get into the plane between the endosteal and periosteal dura. And then you lift the temporal dura from this. So, you get more space. And then this dura propria is gradually elevated over the mandibular branch or V3. And this is again is the diagram you have seen many times, and this is what is the importance of this. V1, V2 and all these areas. Now here, this shows, and V3, if you keep on elevating the dura there, this V3 will take you to Gasserian ganglion. And this is the, under the Gasserian ganglion is petrous apex. So in order to get to the petrous apex, you have to drill or enlarge these foramen of V2 and V3 so that you can retract them to get into that place. This one, no? This is just the calculation from the surface marking, that at this 40% distance from the zygomatic arch, you get into the middle meningeal artery groove. There. Now, GSPN is medial to foramen spinosum. So, when you ligate the middle meningeal artery, you will see GSPN. And under the mandibular nerve, we have seen the relation that foramen spinosum, if you go medial and anterior, you will see the V3, right? And GSPN is medial to foramen spinosum under the mandibular nerve. It is separated from the, while dissecting, it should be separated from the temporal dura and should be left in its group. You don't dissect GSPN with the dura, otherwise this is gone, this will be cut. So you leave this nerve into the groove to prevent, so that seventh nerve injury doesn't occur. And another thing is, later on during surgery, it's a most important landmark. You will keep seeing that GSPN is here, I need not to come here, should not drill here, because IC is there. And one is the lateral loop. Lateral loop is formed by the anterior border of V3 and inferior border of V2. So here, if you see, this between the V2 and V3 is the lateral loop. And now you see this medial to GSPN, posterior to Gasserian ganglion, anterior to arcuate eminence, and medial to petrous ridge. Medial to petrous ridge is your rhomboid. This is the rhomboid. Yeah. So this is a, and I will show you further. This is the very clear. Now always this V3 is anterior. Yeah. Middle meningeal lateral, and you see it's very clear, and we'll show it there in the cadaver. Okay. So this is the rhomboid. And always see the petrous ridge is not a single ridge. These are the two ridges. Petrous ridge is not a single ridge. These are the two. First ridge and second ridge that you have to define. And this again further dissection, and you see very clearly GSPN. And now see the area to be drilled is still not in the picture in this photograph if you see, because it is under the Gasserian ganglia. And now when we have retracted this Gasserian ganglion a little bit, now you start seeing that area which is to be drilled. So while drilling the petrous apex, you usually need two retractors. One should be wedging under the petrous ridge, and other should be holding the anteriorly translocated fifth nerve. Because we have to retract the fifth nerve, then only you will get into the petrous apex. Now petrous apex is drilled also again egg-shelled and then stripped from the ligament, similar to anticlinoid process, what we did in anticlinoid process. So again, now once we have retracted the Gasserian ganglion, see the retractor is there on the dura. Now you see this area which needs to be drilled. So drilling along petrous ridge between arcuate eminence and V3 exposes the dura, limiting the porous acousticus. Now drilling anterior to this porous acousticus exposes posterior fossa dura up to the inferior petrosal sinus, and this is classically after drilling this petrous apex, and this is the shaded area in dots. This area is to be removed. You don't remove the cochlea and you don't remove the interacoustic meatus also, and this is the area which needs to be drilled for petrous apex. Now dura is open, dura that we have already talked, this is the dural opening. Once you have removed the petrous apex, now we need to open the dura. And after opening the dura, the posterior and middle fossa dura openings are connected by you have to ligate the superior petrosal sinus with silk sutures or with clips, and then you open the dura of posterior fossa. And then tentorium is cut along fifth nerve to the dural incision, and you will see that the fourth nerve should be passing into the tentorial leaf. So opening has to be always posterior to the fourth nerve entrance. And while incising the tentorium or connecting the middle fossa and posterior fossa dura, ligating superior petrosal sinus, when you open the tent, the fifth nerve comes. So your incision should be in pulses again, very small, little bit, and then save this fifth nerve. Because this fifth nerve, the Meckel scape comes there, and you have to preserve fifth nerve. So fifth and fourth, these are the two nerves which are at risk while doing this Kawase screening. And this is one small video of this. See this clival meningioma, which was excised by using this Kawase approach. This is the zygomatic arch, just a middle fossa or temporal craniotomy, but removal of zygomatic arch. Now I am retracting the V2. Now got the endosteal and periosteal layers. I'm sorry, it's an old video, so this is a. And now you see this is the V3. Now it is under my high magnification. And now further stripping, you could see the GSPN. And now this is the classical petrous apex. You see like this, totally the compact bone, petrous apex is. So this petrous apex was drilled. and now the temporal dura was opened. And now leg eclipse to ligate the superior petrosal sinus, and then cut in between these two clips. And now with the fifth nerve, you can see there. So you have to be careful to preserve this fifth nerve. And now you see the tumor. So any tumor medial to fifth nerve has to be clival. Clivus tumor, the classical definition is clivus tumor has to be medial to fifth nerve. So I'm working medial to fifth nerve. And now lateral, so it is a petroclival. So it goes medial as well as lateral to fifth nerve. Once you decompress the tumor, and now soon you'll see this is the sixth nerve which is adherent to the tumor. So it could be dissected and pushed away. And then you can see the brainstem, so separated from brainstem. And then whole tumor removed. And this area covered with gel foam. And you can see the preserved fifth nerve. So I think this is the last one. So if you have any questions, you are welcome.
Oh, yes.